I'll stake me other hand, it's lost forever.
Kingdom Hearts V-Cast. After nearly 20 years, this lost Kingdom Hearts game has resurfaced, and what an experience it is. It might not be as pretty, polished, or, well, good, as mainline KH games, but Kingdom Hearts V-Cast is a fascinating piece of the series' history that, if nothing else, never fails to surprise. Today, I'll be walking you through everything this relic has to offer, from the gameplay and story to the music and programming behind it all. Let's begin.
Ha ha! What a blast from the past!
First things first, you've been lied to. There's no such game as Kingdom Hearts V-Cast.
Made up. It was fake.
Well, the game exists, just not by that name. Officially, the title is just Kingdom Hearts. And because it was on the 3D game section of the Verizon storefront, it has also been marketed as Kingdom Hearts 3D. In order to avoid confusion, I'll continue to call it Kingdom Hearts V-Cast for the remainder of the video, as the community has already been doing for decades. Now, the basics. Kingdom Hearts V-Cast was published by the Walt Disney Internet Group, now Disney Interactive, and developed by Superscape. Square Enix was not involved in any way, meaning that V-Cast is not canon to the Kingdom Hearts series. The game was exclusive to Verizon Wireless's broadband service V-Cast, hence the name. The game launched in October 2004 in Japan, and February 2005 in North America in the form of 4 downloadable chapters. Following the closure of V-Cast services in December 2012, it became impossible to download additional chapters, making Kingdom Hearts V-Cast lost. Because only one chapter could be installed on a phone at a time, recovering the game would require finding 4 different decade-old phones, each with a different episode installed. Thanks to the efforts of dedicated video game preservationists within the Kingdom Hearts community, 3 out of the 4 chapters have been recovered. All footage for this video is taken from an emulator, which is unfortunately not able to reproduce the sound, though it's miracle enough that it works in the first place.
Hey! Let's speed it up! Keep the line moving!
Now that the background info's out of the way, let's get into the game itself. For better or for worse, Kingdom Hearts V-Cast uses tank controls. Pressing left and right changes the angle Sora is facing, and pressing forward or back makes him run in that direction. The camera is also bound to the forward and back keys, rotating the face wherever Sora is facing when he starts to move. Sometimes the camera will also be at a fixed angle, usually during platforming segments. The entire command menu is handled by a single action button. It's like the context-sensitive command from the PS2 versions of Kingdom Hearts, only more and worse. Outside of combat, it functions as a jump button. When enemies are around, it changes to an attack button. And yes, this means you cannot jump when enemies are near. You can also use the action button to open chests, pull levers, lock keyholes, open doors, lift and throw crates, grab onto zip lines, file your taxes, and probably some other stuff that I'm forgetting about. Now, I have a bone to pick with KH V-Cast's jump. One of my biggest gripes with the original Kingdom Hearts is that landing from a jump stops all of Sora's forward momentum. Well, Superscape saw that and decided they could do better. What if Sora came to a standstill before even touching the ground? That's right, after a set distance, Sora will plummet straight down. And keep in mind that it is impossible to influence Sora's position once his feet have left the floor, so you best be sure you angled your jump right.
As long as the Keyblade stays with me, I'll have to keep fighting.
I'll be blunt here, combat is not Kingdom Hearts V-Cast's forte. The first problem is the lack of independent camera controls. This is partially mitigated by a generous auto-lock-on, at least when it decides to work. The second issue is the inability to jump when enemies are near. This makes combat essentially two-dimensional, but that's okay since the enemy AI is one-dimensional. And Strike 3 is the processing power of the game engine. Because of the limitations of the mobile system, only one enemy can be loaded in at a time. So, when there's an encounter with 3 bandits, it actually means 3 bandits one after the other. There's a neat bit of dev trickery with the shadows, which spawn in by twos. At any given moment, one of the 2 shadows is always sunken into the floor. While in this invincible state, the shadow actually uses an entirely different model that is two-dimensional, so even though there are 2 shadows on the screen, only one of them is fully loaded in. As you might have picked up on from the footage, combat in V-Cast is limited to designated areas. Each combat zone has a wave of enemies that can be defeated a set number of times, and after that, they will never respawn on the save file again. All enemies will always drop 3 orbs of semi-random types when defeated, money, HP, or MP. If Sora is at full health or full magic, enemies will not drop HP or MP orbs respectively. Defeating part of a wave and exiting the room will reset the progress of that wave. This means if you repeatedly kill half of a wave and reset the room, you can farm infinite money. Enemies will also drop experience points, but only once the entire wave is defeated, so you can't grind it indefinitely like you can with money. Here's a chart with the experience thresholds for leveling up and the associated rewards. As you can see, the only upgrades Sora receives from leveling up are stat bonuses. The money dropped by enemies or found in chests can be used to purchase items at save points. I guess since Square Enix was involved, Moogles got the axe. There are only 4 items: potions and high potions, which automatically restore Sora's health when at 0 HP, and ethers and elixirs, which restore Sora's MP gauge if you try to cast a spell with no MP remaining. The help menu claims that you can see the items in your inventory by pausing the game. This is a lot. There is only one button for using magic, and the game will decide for you which spell Sora casts. It doesn't really matter though, since there are no elemental resistances, and every type of magic deals the same damage as your physical keyblade swings. Regardless of if you're using magic or regular attacks, you won't have any luck pulling off a combo, since enemies get a generous period of invincibility after each hit. Thankfully, Sora is granted the same iframes when you get hit by an attack. Although mandatory battles are relatively few, a fun quirk of the command system makes a number of heartless fights required to progress. See, you can't open chests, interact with these environmental magic icons, or jump to a ledge when enemies are present, so the only path forward is violence. This also works the other way around. If you're in the middle of executing an action, such as carrying a crate, enemies will not spawn. Some other notes on the combat system. It is technically possible to attack in midair if you enter a combat zone while jumping. It even has its own animation, but it's very impractical. There's also a glitch that occurs if you exit and re-enter a combat zone really quickly. The enemy's model spawns, but they cannot attack or be attacked. This can be remedied by resetting the room or simply waiting for the enemy to truly, finally exist.
Do you remember this story?
I'm thinking of a Kingdom Hearts game featuring Sora as a playable character. In this game, Sora starts his journey by entering a sleeping state and travels without Donald and Goofy by his side. He visits new worlds, as well as familiar locations with new layouts. Completing a world sometimes triggers a cutscene where Maleficent is off scheming somewhere, probably without accomplishing much. As Sora travels to each world, he dives further into his dreams. However, this is all part of the villain's plan, as they want to tap into the darkness within Sora and take his power for their own. That's right, it's Kingdom Hearts VCast. Let's get started.
I need to finish training.
The first world is Obstacle Course. It's more tutorial than actual world, and even someone new to the concept of video games should be able to clear it in under 5 minutes. Obstacle Course consists of 6 sections, fittingly named Section 1 through Section 6. These sections test your ability to walk in a vaguely zigzagged line, jump across 2 platforms, jump across 2 platforms but higher, solve a basic crate puzzle, climb a tree, and defeat a single shadow. Riveting. As the training level, Obstacle Course doesn't feature much in the way of narrative, but I'll take this opportunity to point out that the entire game is being narrated by Jiminy Cricket. The whole story is framed as Jiminy recounting one of Sora's adventures, and at the beginning of each world, Jiminy will provide a short summary of the current plot. He only speaks in-game during Obstacle Course, where he gives the movement tutorial instructions as Sora's coach. Also, at the end of every level, you get a score based on your current money and the amount of experience earned, calculated by this formula. Back in the day, you would have been able to upload your scores to an online leaderboard.
Wait a minute! What happened to my home? My island!
With the tutorial cleared, we can move into the game proper. Sora, having set the gummy ship controls to economy wash, dozes off. He wakes up on Swashbuckler's island with no clue of how he got there and no sign of Donald or Goofy. Our only companion on this lonely island is Kaw, who sends us around the island to collect materials for a raft. Hey, that seems familiar. The first item for the raft is the raft itself. By jumping off this kite at the right moment, Sora will knock over the roof of an old tower to form the base of the raft. After this casual destruction of public property, you can continue exploring the island. It's only 5 rooms, so it won't take long before you stumble upon this creepy, heartless altar. In his dreamy state, Sora doesn't recognize the Heartless Emblem, so we proceed forward with a general lack of caution. One quick barrel puzzle later, and you'll have yourself a gem. Place it on the altar, and you get a cutaway to Maleficent brewing something in her cauldron. There are 4 gems that you have to place in the altar scattered around the island, and you can collect them in almost any order. See, Cage, V-Cast, and Swashbuckler's Island especially, incorporates this kind of exploration-based level design that has kind of gone by the wayside after the first Kingdom Hearts. There are no mandatory encounters from the time you start the level until after you finish placing the altar gems, so there's a degree of freedom and non-linearity that's atypical of post-2005 Kingdom Hearts titles. Moving on, we've already covered the first of the 4 gems, and there's a second one in the tower from earlier. A third one can be found at the end of this lava-filled cavern with instant death rolling barrels. To move on to the 4th gem, you actually have to go back and place at least one of the gems in the altar and activate that Maleficent cutscene. After doing that, a crate will wash up on shore that allows you to reach the mast of the raft. Kaw will immediately leave for this new perch, allowing you to smash his barrel to claim the gem hidden inside. Returning to the altar with all 4 gems grants Sora the first of 3 spells, Blizzard. Sora proceeds to fall for the world's most obvious trapdoor, leading to an underground cavern with the sail of the ship and a forced heartless battle. You will die instantly if you fall under this shadow hole thing, so just don't. We climb back up and... who's this? Anti-Sora? Shadow Sora? Anti-Form Sora? Rage Form Sora? That one form of Sora's heartless? Nope, it's Sora's Shadow, an entity unique to Kingdom Hearts V-Cast. Sora's Shadow is never explicitly named, but you'll see pretty quickly why it isn't a direct copy of the KH1 enemies, although I have no doubt that's what the original source for this encounter was. Sora's Shadow moves and attacks exactly as Sora does, only mirrored. Attacking him will only hurt yourself. The only winning move is to trick Sora's Shadow into falling down the obvious trapdoor from earlier. Sora might have won the battle, but Maleficent's schemes aren't over yet. A tendril of darkness suddenly pierces Sora's heart, inflicting him with a deadly poison. Well, Kaw thinks he knows someone who can help, and Sora doesn't have any better ideas. Cast Blizzard on the fully assembled raft to leave Swashbuckler's Island behind, never to be seen again. Side note, if you speak to Kaw after knocking down the tower but before placing the sail, he will advise you to bring snacks for the journey. What you're supposed to do is climb this tree and knock down some coconuts to bring them back to the raft, but it turns out this is entirely optional. If you ignore the coconuts and complete the level as normal, they will spontaneously appear on the raft for the ending cutscene.
I've really started to wonder.
The Wonderland chapter has been lost to time, but we still have a few scraps of information. For instance, here's the text that would have been used for Jiminy's introduction to the world. Based on footage from the single Kingdom Hearts V-Cast trailer and this one screenshot, we know that Sora did, in fact, meet up with the Caterpillar, who told him that he needs to find the teeth of 3 magical creatures to make an antidote. We also have a scene of Donald and Goofy beaming down from the gummy ship, Sora carrying a barrel on a walking platform thing, and a battle with the purple crocodile. We know that Sora finds the first of the 3 teeth here, but that's where our knowledge on Wonderland ends. It's worth noting that the game's files allude to an enemy named Umbrella Bird, possibly a reference to the Umbrella Vultures from Alice in Wonderland. It's not too late, though. If anyone has a 19-year-old Verizon phone laying around with the Wonderland episode still installed, we could extract the data and restore Cage V-Cast to its full state. Maybe I'm just better off waiting for the inevitable remake.
Agrabah is full of holes for rats to hide in.
It wouldn't be a Kingdom Hearts mobile game without Agrabah. The world starts with Sora having another dream, this time about a scarab and a serpent. He wakes up in a standard-sized studio apartment and heads outside. The game establishes that Sora knows Aladdin, but thankfully makes no mention of Abu's whereabouts. Like Swashbuckler's Island, the gameplay of Agrabah revolves around gathering items scattered across the map. This time, an old man refuses to help Sora find a serpent tooth until Sora buys him a cane for 3 gold coins. Coin number 1 is at the end of a platforming segment near where Sora woke up, and coin number 2 is at the end of a similar area, only with a box puzzle and a truly terrible camera angle. Completing this segment also grants fire, which we'll need for the 3rd coin. Now, as you might have noticed, Agrabah has more enemies to fight than just shadows. We have bandits, who spawn in far away and rush you with intent to kill, or spawn right next to the door, sure, that's fair, and these guys will absolutely eviscerate your HP until you learn to exploit their incredibly simple AI. We also have pot spiders, whose camouflage trick really doesn't work when there aren't any normal, non-heartless pots laying around. But there's another enemy who's guarding the path to the 3rd coin, and it's a doozy. That's right, everyone's favorite puzzle mini-boss, the Blue Rhapsody. Blue Rhapsody appears in a room with braziers at each corner, and you have to light them all in order to proceed. Of course, interacting with the environment is illegal during combat, so you have to eliminate the Rhapsody first. You light a torch, and surprise, Sir Rhapsody is back, so you have to take them down a second time in order to light the next torch. However, our boy in blue's favorite move is running away, plus using melee attacks on them will usually provoke an undodgeable counterattack, so you'll end up using a lot of magic to damage them. So, you light Bluey up in flames, move on to the next corner, and it's not a surprise when the Rapster makes the return a second time. This pattern continues until you reach the final corner, but wait, what's that? You've lit the fourth brazier, but nothing's happening. Using the clunky camera to scan the room, the problem becomes clear. Some of the torches are no longer lit. The culprit is none other than the bluest of Rhapsodies. See, every time you chase after them to get a swing in, they run away, and if they run into a corner you had set ablaze, it gets extinguished. Alright, so now there's a puzzle here. You have to form a strategy to kite the Rad Rhapsody away from the lit torches while you commit their murder. But I hope you bought enough ethers and elixirs, since remember, you have to defeat Blue's Clues every single time you want to light a torch. But this all makes perfect sense to anyone who has played the original Kingdom Hearts. Of course the ice-based enemy would put out the flames. Except, no. Not Rhapsody, Blue, oh no. This is Kingdom Hearts V-Cast, and why would we follow expectations? In the strangest move since greenlighting this game, Agrabah's Blue Rhapsody exclusively uses the Fire Spell, as in, the exact same animation as Sora's recently acquired Fire Spell. And, naturally, both Fire and Blizzard deal full damage to this floating little ball of contradictions. Wow.
Wallamel! It's the old Rasputaz. What do you say, kid?
Next up is a series of three mandatory fights against the mummy enemy, whose only attack is slowly shuffling in Sora's general direction. I hope you didn't use all of your magic restoring items on that last encounter, since mummies can only be damaged by magic, and a Sora under level 5 will need at least one ether to take it down. Defeating the first mummy grants access to the crypt, while the other two mummies guard the third golden coin and half of a scarab beetle. With all three golden coins safely in Sora's pockets, you can head back to the merchant and purchase the walking stick. In exchange for the cane, the old man gives Sora the other half of the scarab beetle. You mean to tell me that this old man fought his way through the blue battalion and took the scarab beetle from the crypt? Well, he manages to leave the market without Sora noticing, so maybe he's more powerful than he seems. Returning to the crypt with the full scarab beetle grants access to the Cave of Wonders, and I actually like this iteration of the cave quite a bit. You know what? Quick Cave of Wonders tier list. Kingdom Hearts is an easy first place. The hall alone is more interesting and more intimidating than basically anything else on this list. Recoded is next. I bet you forgot that it had its own Cave of Wonders design, but it's legitimately fun to navigate and keeps the atmosphere and deadly traps of the original. 358 Days Over 2 comes in third place. For all the reused KH1 and KH2 content the game has, I have to give Days credit when it adds something new. Plus, we get to fight Xion here, and that's neat. Number 4 is Kingdom Hearts Dark Road, and yes, it's only this high because of the walking like a carpet line. I'd probably place Kingdom Hearts V-Cast next. I mean, this Cave of Wonders is literally three flooded rooms, but there's this puzzle where you have to freeze the waterfall to place a gem in a monkey altar, and that's something, I guess. Down near the bottom is Kingdom Hearts 2. The only thing I wonder about this cave is when it will be over. Do you think the Genie Jafar fight from Chain of Memories counts as the Cave of Wonders? Well, I do, and it's going to be all the way down here on the list. Try harder. In obligatory last place is Union Cross. Sorry, Abu. Anyway, grabbing the lamp from the Cave of Wonders will cause the room to fill with lava. With rocks blocking the only exit, Sora summons Genie with a truly awe-inspiring animation, and Genie whisks Sora safely away to the palace courtyard. Now, all that's left between Sora and the end of the level is the hardest challenge in Kingdom Hearts V-Cast, the Palace Fish. Just who and why? Is this really the best defense system for the royal family? It doesn't matter, since you can bypass the puzzle entirely with some surprisingly forgiving platforming. Speedrunners, take note. This leads us into the world's final boss. Sadly, it's not the Turquoise March or Marine Roomba, but boring old Jafar. The Jafar fight has two phases. In the first phase, Jafar floats between three platforms and fires magic from a distance, very similar to his KH1 appearance. Jafar is invincible, but once the three platforms are destroyed, he will move on to phase two. Superscape must have realized that all Genie Jafar boss fights are bound for the bottom of the barrel, so they settled for mediocrity instead. Cobra Jafar isn't particularly challenging, just keep casting fire and blizzard until his HP reaches zero, but there's at least this clever gimmick where MP balls will spawn and you have to collect them before Jafar attacks if you want to refill your MP gauge. Anyway, after the battle, Sora collects Jafar's snake tooth for the antidote, because remember, he's been slowly dying of poison this whole time. Shout out to Genie, who's probably the most well-written character in the game. It's not a high bar, but he does have some legitimately charming dialogue. Sora tries wishing for the Heartless to be eliminated, but apparently all-powerful genies don't have jurisdiction over shadow creatures, so Sora's off on his own again to finish the job. After Sora leaves, we get one last cutscene of Maleficent, remember her? In which it's revealed that Donald and Goofy have been captured.
Where Maleficent resides.
Before we had Enchanted Dominion, we had Maleficent's castle. And I'll be honest, in terms of physical layout and intimidation factor, this world has the Birth by Sleep version beat. The level gives off the World That Never Was energy from KH2, where you really feel like you're storming the enemy stronghold. You're opening the front gate, kicking down the drawbridge, and taking the fight to Maleficent. This world introduces three new enemy types: Dark Balls, Air Soldiers, and Maleficent's Axe Goons, called Pig Soldiers in the game's files. All of these are just stronger HP bags with the same attack pattern we've been dealing with all game. Attack, wait, attack, wait, attack, wait. But I do love the Dark Balls Goofy model. As we enter the castle, two of Maleficent's goons stand in Sora's way. There's this guy, who throws boulders that instantly kill Sora, and this other goon who pulls a lever to block the path forward. But you get to do this, which is objectively the funniest thing I have ever seen. Moving onwards, we find Ka trapped in a birdcage, and Sora tries to free him. But, surprise surprise, it's actually Maleficent in disguise. She traps Sora in the cell, steals his keyblade, and then nopes away to another room in the castle. For this next segment, Sora has to traverse the castle without a keyblade. It's Hollow Bastion all over again, except minus one beast and plus one prison break. After this charming little puzzle sequence, we reach the maze, since that's what the final level of a game with tiny screen and poor camera controls needed, a maze. It turns out this maze is literally just a corridor and a square, but trust me when I say it feels a lot more complicated the first time through. Guess who's back? Actually, don't, it's Donald and Goofy. They're back. The two of them are still imprisoned by Maleficent, so they can't help us much. We get this exchange between Sora and Donald, and Goofy seems ready to believe that Sora willingly handed Maleficent the Keyblade, but we have better things to do than hanging around with these cardboard cutouts. The next room is the Orrery. If you didn't know, an Orrery is a kind of planetary model. Maleficent's got this machine that shows the various worlds, so just think of it as an evil magic planetarium. Sora finds the Kingdom Key sitting conspicuously inside a machine. Ignoring the obvious trap, he reclaims the Keyblade, thereby activating the machine. It turns out that Maleficent couldn't use the Keyblade after all, so she needed Sora's pure heart to activate her Heartless Doomsday device. She also took all of the magic out of the Keyblade, and then teleports up a staircase. Now, this next part is one of the most interesting encounters in the game. When Maleficent leaves, she spawns some shadows. What's supposed to happen is that the player realizes they can't defeat them, so they backtrack to the prison cells and use their reclaimed Keyblade to free Donald and Goofy. But I thought, what if? So I spend 15 minutes killing two shadows, only for more to spawn. So, I cheated. I edited the save file to increase Sora's strength from its usual maximum of 4 to 250. And still, this barely does half of one shadow's HP bar. What's more, unlike every other enemy wave in the game, which have enemies in groups of 2, 3, or occasionally 4, this encounter has 10 shadows, each with its ridiculous HP bar. The devs really wanted to make sure that no one got past this point without backtracking first. Defeating all the shadows doesn't give any experience points, not that I'm surprised. Remember, this would have taken over an hour on a regular save file, even with max level Sora. Returning to the intended route, Sora frees Donald and Goofy, who have been busy staring into the middle distance and perfecting their lifeless A-pose. While thinking of a plan, Goofy stumbles around and accidentally reveals a secret passageway in classic Goofy fashion. The secret entrance leads to one of the coolest rooms in the game, the Potion Room. Not only is it where all the cutscenes with Maleficent from earlier took place, it marks the return of Sora's shadow. Rather than fighting them, you have to use the mirror to control Sora's shadow and pick up the Thunder Spell, thus restoring the Keyblade's magic. It does make you wonder why such an important room was only accessible through a prison cell, but I won't question it. As an aside, if you try to leave the Potion Room before solving the puzzle, Donald will keep telling you to go back and search the room some more. He actually has several different lines of dialogue for this specific scenario, a level of detail that's frankly unexpected this far into the experience. After quickly dispatching the goons and Heartless that have replaced the impossibly strong shadows, we reach the final room of the game, the Tower. It's quite intimidating when you first enter the room, and this kind of isolated vertical progression isn't something you typically get on the way to the final boss, so points go to V-Cast for that. As for the climb itself, it's more frustrating than it needed to be, thanks to the fixed camera angles, stiff jump controls, and the abrupt speed boost Sora gets after walking for a few seconds. But it's at least more interesting than the fight at the top. Dragon Maleficent drops HP and MP orbs when you hit her, so any possible challenge the fight could have had is taken away by this infinite resource renewal. Maleficent's demise is quick and painless, at least on our end. Having proved himself the world's worst dentist, Sora collects Maleficent's tooth and ziplines back to the orrery. Upon deactivating the machine, V-Cast presents us with one last platforming puzzle segment for the road. The orrery behind us, we quickly toss the teeth into Maleficent's cauldron and light it on fire, with Goofy's head being acceptable collateral. At last, Sora wakes up, safely back on the gummy ship. This entire adventure was just a dream. Or was it?
Your Majesty, our guests, they want to sing in the musical!
You might have noticed that I haven't been playing any music from Kingdom Hearts V-Cast, and there's a reason for that. It's all really, really short. Each theme loops in under 30 seconds, the Wonderland theme, for instance, is only 14 measures long, and I didn't want to subject any of you to 30 minutes of that. So, some background. Because Square Enix wasn't involved in making V-Cast, Yoko Shibamura did not return to compose the score. Instead, the soundtrack was created by Ian Livingstone, making this his only contribution to the Kingdom Hearts discography. Currently, there's no way to emulate the sound of the game. However, Livingstone was gracious enough to provide the 13th Vessel with the original MIDI files and sound fonts, so we can experience exactly what the music would have sounded like back in 2004. The hardware limitations of Verizon phones severely restricted the scope of the soundtrack. Excluding some 5-second jingles, there are only 6 songs in the game. Each world only has a single theme, which, as mentioned, are all pretty short. Since there are so few of them, I'll go over each song individually. First up, the Obstacle Course theme. Since none of these have official names, I'll be displaying whatever name Livingstone used in his files. This song is a simple and cheerful piece led by a descending piano pattern that, according to Livingstone, was a nod to Dearly Beloved. For Swashbuckler's Island, Livingstone actually composed 2 different themes, although only one made it into the final product. Both of them have a certain spirit of adventure. The first one is bold, with horns, brass, timpani, strings, and tambourine. While the unused one has accordion, bass, acoustic guitar, muted cymbals, fiddle, and tango accordion played over the sound of waves. Both Wonderland and Agrabah use similar instrumentation to Shimomura's originals. Wonderland has a whimsical flute melody supported by piano, pizzicato strings, and marimba, just like KH1's Welcome to Wonderland. Parallels between Livingstone's Agrabah theme and Shimomura's A Day in Agrabah are less concrete, although both use exotic instrumentation. The V-Cast melody is played on a shakuhachi, which is a surprisingly common choice for video game OSTs. Thank you. like with Swashbuckler's Island, there are two versions of Maleficent's castle's theme. Both of them have prominent arpeggios and incorporate harp, celesta, and various string instruments. It's worth noting that for the unused version of the song, the recording provided by the 13th Vessel in their soundtrack video is actually incomplete. All but a single note of the flute counter melody is cut out. I've been keeping something from you. The Kingdom Hearts VCast motif chart. That's right. While the music doesn't contain any motivic material from Shimomura's soundtracks, it does contain a single internal reference. The song that plays on the Game Over screen, fittingly titled Death Music, incorporates elements of the obstacle course theme. Finally, we have the 5-second jingles I alluded to earlier. There's not much to say about these, so I'll just let them play. The one titled Bad Music reminds me of the unnamed Mission Defeat theme from Kingdom Hearts Union Cross. Take another listen.
Here, data can be copied.
I'll keep this one short, but I wanted to share a bit about how the game's save files work, since I don't believe anyone has documented this before. Game saves use a .dat file. On the right is the plain text that is saved to the file, and on the left are the corresponding hex values that the game uses. There are sets of zeros dividing each relevant section of data. Over here is Sora's current HP, his max HP, his MP, and max MP. The next line contains Sora's money, strength, defense, and experience, while the line after that stores Sora's level and the amount of potions, high potions, and ethers currently in stock. The following line is where it gets interesting, though. There are four digits before the name of the world that represent the spell Sora has unlocked. For instance, 0001 is no magic, 0101 is only the blizzard spell, and 1111 is all three spells. What's strange is that it's written in ASCII characters rather than hex, which takes up more bytes of data. What's stranger is that the world name is written in ASCII as well. Instead of having a single byte devoted to a simple stage counter, they write out the name of the level in full, which also means that the default save file is a different length depending on the number of letters in the world name. My guess is that it has something to do with each .m3g file starting with the same world names, so maybe it tells the game what prefix to look for? Don't take my word for it. Anyway, pretty much everything after that is an event flag that gets added as you play the game. Engage with a wave of shadows, add a wave's killed flag to keep track of it. Open a chest, add a flag to let the game know to remove it from the environment. Nothing too revolutionary here, but interesting to see nonetheless.
I've found another door leading to extra data.
I have some final pieces of information that didn't fit in anywhere else, so I'll give them to you here rapid fire. If you kill the shadow in the combat tutorial and quit the game before collecting the key, the chest will never spawn and your save file will be permanently softlocked. There's another easy softlock in Maleficent's castle. Just walk over this ladder while holding the goon, and Sora will be stuck floating forever. The password to get into Agrabah's palace is not, in fact, password. Goofy's render has his hair on fire from the ending cutscene. The normal version is likely lost to the Wonderland files. A max level Sora can defeat shadows in a single hit, and it's incredibly satisfying. While I wouldn't call VCast a particularly funny game, the dramatic camera zooms are, in my opinion, hilarious. This is the only Kingdom Hearts game in which you can save while running. For some reason, you still have control over Sora during the cutscene that plays when you first enter the orrery. Walking backwards to exit the room skips the cutscene. According to Livingstone, the entire soundtrack was likely created in the span of 1 month. Sora cannot swim backwards. There's no experience cap, but Sora will stop gaining experience points after reaching level 9 at 500 EXP. This creates a soft maximum of 559 EXP, since you can earn a maximum of 60 experience points from any one encounter. The caterpillar tells Sora to drink the potion made from the three teeth. Donald, on the other hand, advises Sora to jump into the boiling cauldron. Two event flags are added to the save file when Sora uses magic on the pillars in the orrery. However, they must not have been programmed correctly, since you can trigger the collapse even once the pillars have already fallen. Chest 1 in the maze in Maleficent's castle does not have anything inside of it. A Verizon press release describes Sora as meeting over 20 characters. There are 8 enemy types, 2 more for Wonderland, 3 bosses, Ka, Donald, Goofy, the Caterpillar, Genie, the 2 Agrabah NPCs, and Sora's Shadow. Exactly 21.
It's over now! You lost!
And that's it. That's everything Kingdom Hearts V-Cast has to offer. Looking back, it's pretty easy to see the Kingdom Hearts 1 influence on this title. We have tighter, more confined level design, as well as a stronger emphasis on platforming and exploration. We also have Disney characters possessing knowledge of outside worlds, which isn't very common nowadays. And, even if it was all a dream, this is probably the closest Maleficent has come to accomplishing her goals since that original title, so there's that. To rediscover an infamously lost piece of Kingdom Hearts media was a truly fascinating experience, and I hope you've enjoyed learning about this forgotten sliver of Kingdom Hearts history. While it's obviously not of the same quality as Square Enix's titles, V-Cast has a certain irreplicable charm to it. I wasn't able to show off absolutely every room, encounter, or cutscene, so if you do choose to play the game yourself, there's still plenty left to discover. And remember, Wonderland might still be out there, so don't lose hope. But we don't have to worry about that today. Today's about friends and laughter, hope and promise, blue skies and sunshine.